churches in Christ.
Good evening. We welcome you to the Trinity Lutheran service broadcast direct from the Trinity Lutheran Church here in Faribault, Minnesota. We're celebrating the second of our midweek Lenten services. Our speaker this evening is our pastor, the Reverend Paul Rieger, who will speak on "Were You There When He Was Denied?" based on Mark chapter 14, verses 66 to 72. Hymns this evening are hymns 346, "Jesus and Shall It Ever Be," found in the Lutheran hymnal. Hymn number 436 in the Lutheran service book, "Go to Dark Gethsemane." Hymn number 456 in the Lutheran service book, "Were You There?" And hymn number 953 in the Lutheran service book, "The New Testament Canticle." And our last hymn this evening is hymn number 693 in the Lutheran service book, "O Holy Spirit, Grant Us Grace." Again, those hymns are hymn number 346, 436, 456, 953, and 693. Our organist this evening is Mrs. Barb Marasco, and special music by Barb Beatty. Our opening hymn this evening is hymn number 346, found in the Lutheran hymnal, "Jesus and Shall It Ever Be." That's hymn number 346 in the Lutheran hymnal.
We rise. We make our beginning this evening in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This is the day which the Lord has made. From the rising of the sun to its setting. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful. Jesus said, if any man would come after me, Christ was wounded for our transgression. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. We're now going to chant responsively Psalm 89. My faithfulness and my steadfast love shall be with him, and in my name shall his horn be exalted. I will set his hand on the sea, and his right hand on the rivers. He shall cry to me, you are my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation. And I will make him the firstborn, the highest of the kings of the earth. My steadfast love I will keep for him forever, and my covenant will stand firm for him. I will establish his offspring forever, and his throne as the days of the heavens. If his children forsake my law, and do not walk according to my just decrees, if they violate my statutes, and do not keep my commandments, then I will punish their transgression with the rod, and their iniquity with stripes. Remove him from steadfast love, or be false to my faithfulness. I will not violate my covenant, or alter the word that went forth from my lips. Once for all I have sworn by my holiness, I will not lie to David. His offspring shall endure forever, his throne as long as the sun before me. Like the moon it shall be established forever, a faithful witness in the skies. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. You may be seated as we continue on with our epistle reading. Our epistle reading this evening comes to us from 1 John chapter 1. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie, and we do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus his Son cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. This is the word of the Lord. We will now have our Passion dramatic reading.
The sufferings and death of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to the four evangelists.
Little children, I shall be with you a little while longer. You will seek me, and as I said to the Jews, where I am going, you cannot come. So now I say to you, a new covenant I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, I will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another.
Simon Peter said to him,
Lord, where are you going?
Jesus answered him,
where I am going, you cannot follow me now, but you shall follow me afterward.
Peter said to him,
Lord, why can I not follow you now? I will lay down my life for your sake.
Jesus answered him,
will you lay down your life for my sake?
And the Lord said,
Simon, Simon, indeed, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail. And when you have returned to me, strengthen your brethren.
But he said to him,
Lord, I am ready to go with you both to prison and to death.
Then he said,
most assuredly, I say to you, Peter, the rooster shall not crow this day before you deny me three times that you know me.
He said to them,
when I sent you out without money bag, knapsack, and sandals, did you lack anything?
So they said,
no, no, nothing at all, Lord.
Then he said to them,
but now, he who has a money bag, let him take it, and likewise a knapsack. And he who has no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. For I say to you that this which is written must still be accomplished in me. And he was numbered with the transgressors. For the things concerning me have an end.
So they said,
Lord, look, here are two swords.
And he said to them,
it is enough.
Please join us in listening or singing to our office hymn this evening, hymn number 436 in the Lutheran Service Book, Go to Dark Gethsemane. That's hymn number 436 in the Lutheran Service Book.
When Jesus had spoken these words, and having sung a hymn, he went out with his disciples over the brook Kidron to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. Then Jesus said to them,
"All of you will be made to stumble because of me this night, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee."
Peter answered and said to him,
"Even if all are made to stumble because of you, I will never be made to stumble."
Jesus said to him,
"Assuredly, I say to you that today, even this night, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times."
But Peter spoke more vehemently,
"If I have to die with you, I will not deny you."
And they all said likewise. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, where there was a garden which he and his disciples entered, and Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. When Jesus came to that place, he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I go and pray over there. Pray that you may not enter into temptation."
And he took with him Peter, James, and John, the two sons of Zebedee, and he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. Then he said to them,
"My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch with me."
And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and prayed. He went a little farther and fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said,
"Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will. Not my will, but yours be done."
Then he came and found them sleeping and said to Peter,
"Simon, are you sleeping? What? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak."
Again, a second time he went away and prayed, saying,
"Oh, my Father, if this cup cannot pass away from me unless I drink it, your will be done."
And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy, and they did not know what to answer him. So he left them, went away again, and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. Then he came the third time and said to his disciples,
"Are you still sleeping and resting? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners.
Thank you. Let us rise for the reading of our Holy Gospel. Our Gospel this evening comes to us from the Gospel according to Mark, the 14th chapter. And as Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came, and seeing Peter warming himself, she looked at him and said, "You also were with the Nazarene, Jesus." But Peter denied it, saying, "I neither know nor understand what you mean." And he went out into the gateway, and the rooster crowed. And the servant girl saw him and began again to say to the bystanders, "This man is one of them." But again he denied it. And after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, "Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." And he began to invoke a curse on himself and to swear, "I do not know this man of whom you speak." And immediately the rooster crowed a second time. And Peter remembered how Jesus had said to him, "Before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times." And he broke down and wept. This is the word of the Lord.
Please join us in listening or singing to our hymn for the Passion this evening, hymn number 456, verses 1 to 2, "Were You There?" That's hymn number 456 in the Lutheran Service Book, "Were You There?" Followed by Pastor Paul Rieger's sermon, "Were You There When He Was Denied?" based on Mark chapter 14, verses 66 to 72.
Dear friends in Christ, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Were you there when he was denied? One of my favorite Easter memories is that at Trinity in St. Louis, my old church, at Easter time on Good Friday, at the very end of the service, after they had stripped the altar and everything was just gone, the lights would go out in the church. And they would shine a spotlight on the cross, and a male soloist would sing, "Were You There?" And it is the most moving thing to me. I still get goosebumps thinking about it, and I haven't been there in years. It's so passionate. It's such a beautiful song. It's kind of some of those old gospel hymns that, with a lot of emotion behind them. So visceral. It's so passionate. I just love it. As I was talking with some people last week about the Lenten season, just kind of just talking about everything that was going on, we were talking about why we loved the season of Lent so much. Being a pastor, that's actually a conversation that I normally have, you know. But it's not like Christmas, right? Christmas is a happy season. It's a season we all get to enjoy, but it doesn't have the same feeling that Lent does. So what's so different about Lent? And as we were talking about it, it's all three of us really had that same answer. It's because of the emotion that you feel during Lent. There's so many different churches that I've been a part of where you feel so involved. I think we do a great job here with these passion readings. You feel like you're actually there, hearing it all happen, hearing it all go on. You see so many different emotions through all the music, through all the readings, all these sort of things that we do. It puts you there. And so that's what our sermon series is going to follow, is putting yourself there in the season of Lent. Of course, it's based off of that powerful hymn and our wonderful music ministry at this church. We got together and we made up a couple of verses so that it would work with my sermon themes, which I'm very proud of, so thank you very much. But today we're going to look at Peter. We're asking, were you there when Jesus was denied? Now, Peter is the most zealous disciple. He is the guy that's going to stand up and declare his faith in front of everyone. Our passion reading really showed a great example of it. Peter said, "Lord, I'd rather die than deny you." That's Peter. Peter's going to be the first one to say that. All the other guys are definitely thinking the same way, but Peter's the first one to say it. Our chapel theme this year at FLS is Upon This Rock, and it's based off of Peter's confession that Jesus is Lord, that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. And Jesus commends Peter for that confession of faith and says, "Upon that confession of faith, I will build my church." Peter is the guy. He's the apostle of the apostles. And Peter's name isn't even Peter, it's Simon, right? Peter's a nickname. Peter comes from Greek, which is Petros, which means rock, right? He's also got another nickname, Cephas, Aramaic, for rock. This guy is the guy. It is so important and vital that you understand how big Peter's faith is, that you can understand how devastating the betrayal is. So let's place ourselves there. Let's try and get into this Lenten season, all this emotion, and place ourselves in that dark courtyard. This is right after Jesus' arrest. It's late at night. It might even be very early in the morning. It's cold. It's a bitter cold. There's a wind whipping through, and it is chilling you to the bones. And so everybody in the courtyard is gathering around this fire. They can tell there's a commotion going on, that this Jesus guy has been arrested. And it's a big deal, so you're kind of looking on to see what's going to happen. And at that, you notice there's this guy there. You recognize him. And we switch over to Peter, and you can see Peter there, sitting, reflecting on everything that's happening. The face that he has on is just solemn, reflective, a little sad. In the back of Peter's mind the whole time are the words of Jesus saying, "Before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times." And Peter, being so zealous, having that strong faith that he has, he's just beating himself up. He knows that Jesus is Lord. He knows that Jesus is all-knowing. But he can't believe it. How can I deny my Lord, my God? I can't even believe that I would do it even once, let alone three times. And you can see Peter just thinking on this, thinking and thinking. And this little servant girl comes up to him. She looks him over. She says, "You were with Jesus, that guy from Nazareth. You were with him." And Peter immediately denies it. "I have no idea what you're talking about. I don't know this guy. Don't worry about it." And at that, the rooster crows. And the servant girl begins talking to all of those people gathered in the courtyard, saying, "I'm sure this guy was with him. This man is one of them." Peter, of course, sitting by, hears it and says, "No, you're wrong. I'm not a part of this crowd." And finally, this group of people who are all warming themselves in the courtyard, watching all the activities, begin talking among themselves. And one of them approaches Peter, grabs him by the arm, and gets close to him and says, "Certainly, you're one of them. You have to be one of them. You're from Galilee. Why else would you be here?" And you can see Peter just getting so upset. His brow starts to furrow. You can hear these angry words start coming out of his mouth. And he finally speaks up saying, "I do not know this guy. I don't know him." Denying Jesus a third time. But then Peter hears it as the rooster crows a second time. And at that moment, Peter remembers the words of Jesus. "Before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times." And at that, Peter crumbles. His heart breaks in two. Peter is this tough, zealous man, the apostle, and he is just breaking down, weeping at how he has just completely forsaken the man that he has called Lord. He is mourning how he has denied his God. Have you been there? Maybe you haven't denied Jesus, but maybe you've denied a friend, denied someone that you love and care for. Have you ever gone out with a group of people to a movie and forgotten, maybe quote-unquote forgotten, maybe you didn't want to invite someone along? When you were ever in school, you ever see somebody getting bullied or picked on and maybe you turned aside so you didn't have to make eye contact? What about at work? Have you ever seen a coworker struggling and you made an effort to avoid them so you didn't have to deal with their problems? Denial is not just the sort of thing that we see Peter doing, right? Denial ain't just a river in Egypt. Denial is something that's everywhere. Denial is something, it's quite possibly the most selfish thing we can do. Is to completely ignore others. We'd rather not be included with that person. We'd rather not be seen going out with that person. We'd rather not deal with that person's problems. But do you, like Peter did, do you deny Jesus? It might not be an open denial where you're saying that I am not a Christian or have no idea who that Jesus guy is. Maybe it's just that you avoid being included with Christians. Maybe it's that you do not speak up when someone's slandering the name of your Lord and your God. Maybe it's avoiding those tough conversations with your family, friends, loved ones, and letting them instead continue in their sin, which is destroying their lives, rather than being renewed by Christ. But even in our denials, even those very selfish sins, that's what Christ came for. After Peter denies Jesus, Jesus goes on to receive a horrible beating before being executed on a cross, being nailed to that cross, dying a very painful death. And this is the payment for all sin. Those selfish sins, those sins where we say, I don't really care about the other person, I don't want to deal with that right now. Jesus paid for those sins. That sin that Peter committed by denying his Lord and his God three times, denying his friend, forgiven. That's what Jesus came for. He came to bring forgiveness to a world who could be so zealous and so proud to say, I love my God, I will die before I deny my Christ, and then immediately deny the Christ. Jesus came for that world that lies, that is selfish, that denies. And Jesus came to make it new. Jesus became the ultimate sacrifice to pay for our selfishness, our sinful ways, and to renew us. Now, I'm not trying to make you hear this and feel guilty. Oh, well, Jesus died for me. I guess maybe I shouldn't have been selfish like that. But I also don't want you to think that the opposite of denial is running around shouting at everybody about the love of Christ. But I want you to reflect, because I truly feel that Lent is a good season, a good time, a good 40 days to reflect on everything that's going on. Reflect on who Jesus is. Reflect on who you are in him. Reflect on denial. We know that Jesus is Lord. We know that in him we are made new. And we know that denial is something selfish that we do. It's allowing that old self to forget who we have become in Christ. So then how do we change? Because you might know Jesus. You might know of this gift. You might know of that wonderful forgiveness he brings. But you still might deny people, ignore people. You still might be selfish. Because if you're anything like me, you try and you fail. You want to stick up for others. You don't want to deny Jesus, but you fail. And thankfully, Jesus' sacrifice is not a one-time thing. It doesn't just cover one sin once. It covers all sins for all time. And the renewal that God gives us is not a one-time deal. It is a constant thing. We are being continually renewed. Because even though we deny God, we deny others, God does not deny us. He looks at us. He looks at us in our sins, in our most filthy place, and he says, come home. Return to me. And what's amazing, what's so wonderful, is that once we are a part of God's family, he never denies us. We are the only ones that can lose. We are the only ones who can push God away. God doesn't push us away. He does not deny us. We can wander from our faiths. We can wander and wander for years and years. But we can still return to him, because God will never deny us. So God is always on our side. And with God forgiving you of everything, with God forgiving even Peter, who denied Christ right to his face three times, with that amount of forgiveness, what do you do? What are you going to do? How does doing what we're doing here in Lent, placing yourselves there, saying, were you there in the courtyard when Jesus was denied? How does that help you improve as a Christian? And my hope My prayer is that by placing yourself there, especially during this season of reflection, is that you get that experience. That you feel that weight that Peter felt on his heart. That you feel that heartbreak that Peter felt. But that you also feel the relief, the love, and the grace that God gives. Knowing who your God is, receiving that forgiveness, receiving that renewal. Because look at Peter, right? After Peter denies Jesus, witnesses the crucifixion, sees his risen Lord, what happens after that? Peter goes out to spread the gospel. He helps start the church. And so what should you do after knowing this relieving forgiveness of Jesus? Spread the gospel. You don't have to start the church. We're already here. But you can tell others about Christ and that renewal that God brings you every single day. Allow more people to know that relief from the burden of their sins. Spread the gospel and help people know what it means to be forgiven. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We're going to continue on in our worship by gathering our tithes and our offerings. I'd also encourage you to fill the little red friendship pads at the ends of your pews.
God loved us and sent
Please join us in listening or singing to our New Testament canticle, hymn number 953 in the Lutheran Service Book. That's hymn number 953 in the Lutheran Service Book, the New Testament canticle.
And let us join together in prayer. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you give us. We thank you especially tonight that you have not denied us. We know, Lord, that we have been selfish, that we have been sinful, and that we have denied you in our lives, whether publicly or privately. We know that we are in need of forgiveness, and we thank you for sending us your Son, Jesus, who was denied even by you, so that we would be forgiven. We pray, Lord, that thank you first off for the forgiveness that you give us, the renewal that it brings in our hearts. But we pray, Lord, that you would help us to live this forgiveness, this renewal, that we would change our lives and that we would preach this gospel so that other might know the blessings that you have given us. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, we pray for all of our loved ones, but we especially lift up for strength, comfort, and healing Kurt, Hank, Jenna, Jerry, Leslie, Lily, Lisa, Robin, Mandy Bloom, Cynthia Karen, Austin Ellerbush, Marion Hagel, Mary Hayer, John Maluski, Dwayne Reimhilt, Donna M. Schultz, Elsie I. Schultz, Kay Smith, Francis Swee, Iola Wiskoski, and all those names which we carry in our hearts, which we pray before you now. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for all of those who mourn the loss of loved ones. We pray especially for the family and friends of Marion Frechtry, mother of Marla Sturck, who passed away on March 5th. We pray, Lord, for this family, that you would surround them with your love, but you would especially surround them with your people who will love them, care for them, be with them in their mourning, but especially point them to the hope that we have in the resurrection on the last day. Help us all to remember the victory you have won for us, especially in the face of death. Lord, in your mercy, trusting, taught by our Lord and trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve you all. Amen. We close in song.
Please join us in listening or singing to our closing hymn, hymn number 693 in the Lutheran Service Book, O Holy Spirit, Grant Us Grace. That's hymn number 693 in the Lutheran Service Book. As we come to the close of another midweek Lenten service, we pray it will be a blessing to you and will strengthen your faith in Christ. This is a direct broadcast from the Trinity Lutheran Church here in Faribault, Minnesota. Our speaker this evening was our pastor, the Reverend Paul Rieger, who spoke on, "Were you there when he was denied?" based on Mark chapter 14, verses 66 to 72. Our organist this evening is Mrs. Barb Morosco, and special music was by Barb Beatty. We return you now to the main studios of KDHL until this coming Sunday at 8 a.m.